people of the internet. My name is JD Shadow, and yeah, let's talk about it. Let's talk about the current situation about YouTube and the demonetization and how things are right now as it pertains to the ad-friendly and family-friendly and so on and so forth about how YouTube videos are either getting demonetized or they are getting completely flagged as being inappropriate. Now, before we go any further, a bit of the disclaimer, I too have had my own videos demonetized in a few instances. Quite simply, the ones about PewDiePie and the situation about what he's been going through recently. And there were a few others, including the special report I did about how a Steven Universe fan artist was almost driven to commit suicide after some vitriol was leveled toward her about some of her drawings not being PC. Those were demonetized. And here's the thing, no one knows why. No one has any idea as to why. No one has any idea why the videos are getting demonetized, because YouTube will not communicate with anybody about anything. And this is something that we have told YouTube about several times now. They have been told about it again and again and again, and they have not done a single thing to address that whole thing, where they just will not say a word. And it's gotten to a point where people getting frustrated, extremely frustrated, because they're hearing about these companies that are pulling ads from YouTube on the explicit notion that their ads are running alongside racist, bigoted videos. Now, this is according to the same people from the Wall Street Journal that tried to take PewDiePie out of context, give that a, so you can take that for what it's worth. There's been some suspicion about how they came to these conclusions that a Coca-Cola ad was playing alongside a video in which the N-word was used in the title. Now, of course, it is entirely possible that could be the case, but you would have to refresh the page several times, probably, in order to get that particular ad to show up on that particular video. And YouTube has recently came out with a bit of added guidelines in order to lock all this down because of the advertiser scare that is going on with people like Volkswagen and Starbucks and Pepsi, Coca-Cola pulling ads on the back of this whole controversy. Johnson & Johnson was one of the sponsors that decided, hey, we might be a little overzealous about this whole thing, and decided to come back. YouTube has now said that they are going to crack down on certain things, and they will only start putting ads on videos when you have reached 10K lifetime views on your channel. Now, what is unclear about this is whether or not this is 10K lifetime views altogether, or do you have to get 10K new lifetime views in order to be enlisted into monetization and getting ads on your channel. If it is the latter, and I don't know why it would be, but I'm just throwing it out there just in case they're thinking about it, and so we catch it before they think about doing it, then it would be highly unfair to anybody that they would have to get 10K more views in order to be able to get ads on their videos, especially when they have proven themselves beforehand. Now, this is not saying that they can't get 10K more views, I'm not saying that, but for a smaller channel that might have just gotten their video blown up by views, they just got a video that everybody kind of liked, like myself, or by Gaylor Moon, or somebody who saw a particular video of theirs get massively popular, and they're having a hard time trying to duplicate that success. You could probably see that as kind of hard for a smaller channel to do when they just had one or two particular videos reach that level. And plus, you've already got 10K views, why do you need to prove yourself once again? Even if you are able to easily get that many views, why do you have to? But again, that's just me making sure that we address that point in case somebody isn't catching it and YouTube tries to pull a fast one on people before somebody points it out that it could be possible. But here is where things get a little bit weird. And this is where I have to say, I kind of told people about this. In a recent video, David Pakman on his David Pakman show said that a YouTube sponsor wanted to specifically advertise on the David Pakman show. And they specifically said that they wanted to advertise on things like David Pakman, secular talk, so on and so forth. Especially on David Pakman show where they get the most views from. They get the most impressions from. And recently they have seen that the impressions went down significantly. So they asked YouTube specifically to say, hey, we want our advertising on the David Pakman show. And YouTube is refusing to allow them to do that. And it is sort of saying that there is a sort of blacklist of particular channels that YouTube does not want ads to be run on. And David listed some of the videos that were demonetized, and most of those do not make any damn bit of sense. Why would you demonetize any of those videos? Why would you go to that length? Unless, of course, it has to do something with the tags he used. But if we're talking about tags in videos and titles and all of that, remember my PewDiePie videos, I tried to actually remove some of the what I would consider to be offending tags, and they still did not approve the monetization. I'm still fighting that. You can appeal probably all the times you want, but it's up to YouTube and YouTube alone to decide whether or not they should be monetizable. The problem is no one is saying anything about what the problem is, and it seems that YouTube is in no hurry to address that concern or cares that it is a concern or think it is no concern. That is where the problem lies. And for a advertiser to be outright refused by YouTube is showing what I have been saying, is that YouTube is not giving the advertisers a choice in the matter. They're not giving the advertisers any sort of choice to decide where they want their advertising dollars to be, what particular videos they want to advertise on. And that would be a step in the right direction. That would be a solution for YouTube. Say, hey, what kind of content would you like your videos to be on? Because Johnson & Johnson may not want to advertise on, say, a Let's Play video, but Capcom or Square Enix might, because every particular advertiser has a particular demographic they are trying to cater to. They are trying to reach their potential buyers, somebody who would actually want to buy their product. And on gaming content, hey, you might want to buy that game that Square Enix is trying to advertise for you on one of my Let's Plays. They might want to get your attention. They might want to cater to that particular audience that they wouldn't on, say, a video about crafting or about sewing or something like that. They would try to get your attention in that way. But it is YouTube acting on behalf of everybody, and they're not communicating anything with content creators. And this gets a particularly messier situation, because this wouldn't be so much of a problem. The Wall Street Journal could not have done this if people did not listen to it. But here's the thing. We are putting so much stock into how these people report these things. The Wall Street Journal could not have taken PewDiePie so out of context so successfully if people would not believe him at their absolute word, if they gotten a couple of different sources and then judged based on that. But they took the Wall Street Journal, and that was the only source they ever looked at. That is the absolute only source. Now, you can safely say that they went straight to Maker Studios and they had no chance in order to say, wait a minute, hold up, back up for a second. What are you saying here? Are you saying that PewDiePie is anti-Semitic? Are you saying that? Or what are you going on about? But because they went to Maker Studios first, and Maker Studios already had a problem with paying PewDiePie, apparently. And we all know that is the case. We all know the real reason why Maker Studios let go of PewDiePie. He had a special contract for his channel on that network, an MCN that couldn't pay out. So they used that as an excuse in order to get out of the contract. It is that simple. And anybody who is telling you otherwise is flat out lying to you, because the writing was on the wall there. When Maker Studios released me and 1,000 of other channels, that was the reason why. They could not pay out anybody else other than their highest echelon. The people they knew could make the money for them, that could be able to have their ad revenue be siphoned from them to Maker Studios in order to make sure that they were above water, that they were in the black. That is the only reason. Do not, please do not think for a second it had anything to do with what PewDiePie was putting out, what he wasn't putting out. It had nothing to do with that. Maker Studios knew exactly how to get out of that contract. project. And the Wall Street Journal gave them the exit strategy. Now, as far as YouTube and Google partnership, that is what we're talking about here. And it gets even messier when we talk about JonTron, because it's mostly when JonTron came out and he said the things that he said on the Destiny podcast. Did anybody who read things from Kotaku or Polygon or anything else of that sort had actually watched the response video that PewDiePie and JonTron had made for their respective situations and what JonTron was trying to say and it came out all wrong? Did anybody go to these particular sources and go to other sources and see whether or not what they were being told was the absolute truth? Remember, Fox News had done that for some time. They had treated opinions as fact. They had skewed the truth. They had spun the truth. You think for a second that the other side doesn't do that? You think that the conservatives and the right wing are so guilty of all of this stuff, which they are, but then the left wing media doesn't do that? That they're squeaky clean? They come out smelling like a rose? Absolutely not. And this is the firm example of that. Was JonTron talking about every single minority out there, every single person that can identify as a minority, or was he trying to talk about a fringe group of people? I do not know that. I still haven't listened to the entirety of that podcast, so I cannot say one way or the other. It was a stupid thing to say. It was something that he was not ready for. However, that having been said, we should be getting our news from several different sources. Go and look up things on Google. Go to the source. Go to the person that said it. Find out if that's what they said. That is not that hard to do, and I don't understand why people do not do that. The second someone from a wild source, from a strange source, says, hey, this guy did this, suddenly we believe him before we even hear from the person who's being accused. Doesn't the accused get their right to defend themselves in court? Have we forgot what due process even is? Or is that too inconvenient to do because it takes away from what you are trying to do or what you're trying to accomplish or what you're trying to push? But here's the thing, I'm digressing from the original point about YouTube taking away these ads from these particular videos. But this is the genesis of it. This is where it all started. And this is the reason why that this is becoming so successful. Make no mistake, the Wall Street Journal and people like them have a vested interest in killing this particular medium. And we have been saying this again and again and again. But the one thing that people have to do in order for us to get through to them is for them to listen. Don't just go to Kotaku. Don't just go to Wall Street Journal or Polygon or wherever you're getting your news from. We're telling you that they're questionable sources. We're telling you that. This is no conspiracy. We're telling you, this is not a conspiracy by us to say, oh, we want to discredit something that is giving you correct information because we're guilty of sin. No, we're telling you this because we know better. We're telling you this because we have seen it happen in the past. And unless you question them just once, just question them just once, why is it that hard to do that? Then maybe you'll have enough information to call them out. We're telling you this because we've seen it happen. We're not doing it because of some big, vast conspiracy going on. There's no conspiracy here. This is not us all banding together to try to push some people out of the industry or push people out of a conversation. That's not it. Unless, of course, you're talking about the fringe groups, which there probably are doing that. But why are you giving them attention? Why are you giving them power? Why are you giving them a voice? But then comes the other problem, is that who do you consider as part of that fringe? I've said it before that there are people who you can clearly see are racist and homophobic and misogynistic by themselves. You don't have to guess whether or not something they said was in that realm. But then you go on to those quote-unquote two-way things, which can be taken either way. Which, if someone was criticizing someone who was a woman or who was of a different race or a different nationality or a different religion about their work or about their character, all someone has to say is that, oh, you wouldn't say that to a white person or you wouldn't say that to a male, all of a sudden they're protected without even getting into what the criticism is or if it actually holds any water to it, if it has any bit of credibility to it. If we're telling you that, hey, your game has a control issue or has some graphics issues or your game is just not that fun to play and your only defense is to, one, block somebody who's saying it from your Twitter account or your social media account, or two, to say, hey, you are bigoted because you're saying that to me, and people completely believe them without even delving into what the criticism even is, like what happened with the Ghostbusters reboot in 2016, if you remember the kerfuffle about that. If you believe stuff like that, then it's never going to change. You are always going to have these fringe groups going after each other's throats, and the moderates are left wondering how do they get a voice without being lumped into one of these two fringe sides, because they have been, and that is where we stand. That's why we're at this point. That is why the Wall Street Journal is being so successful. It's because so many people will not give their accused a chance to defend themselves, and the Wall Street Journal is hoping that you never give them a chance to defend themselves. This is what they want. They want this anarchy. They want this thing to never get fixed, because they want YouTube to die. This is what they want, and you're giving it to them on a silver platter. You're not thinking twice. Or maybe we are, and there's a particular third party at work here, because here's where I think there could be a third party at work, and it took a long time for me to get to this point, and I apologize, but I wanted to get that out of the way so we could talk about what could be an issue here that we need to address. One, Wall Street Journal contacted these particular advertisers and say, what do you think about this? What do you think about this? They knew exactly what they were doing. They were trying to say, hey, would you like to get out of this? You don't want us getting on your case. You don't want any other bad publicity. They knew exactly what they were doing. They're doing this for years. They know how to get people to believe their side of the story before they even consider the other side. And of course, we believe them, and the advertiser believed them before they even thought about anything else. But they are not the only third party I am talking about. Let's talk a little bit about the JonTron Playtonic situation again, because I think it needs to be brought up once more because of what this has to do with the YouTube advertiser boycott. Why does it have anything to do with it? Why does it have anything to do with this? Take into consideration one of the main players in telling Playtonic what their stance is about the JonTron situation. What we said it was on the special report, keep in mind who was the main site accused of getting Playtonic to play ball in this situation. It was NeoGAF. And I believe I posted on the special report the photos of the people who were saying that they were trying to contact Playtonic in order to be able to do something about that. Now, there was a comment on that particular special report saying that they don't think NeoGAF has as much of a pull as people think they do. Now, on Playtonic's end, they probably already had been thinking that they wanted to drop JonTron off of Ukulele, which, by the way, has been mixed in the reviews. And we'll get to that in a minute, because I think it has something to do with this whole entire situation as well, with at least NeoGAF's role in that. But Playtonic had acted like utter children in that regard. And like I said, they had every right to do what they did, but we have every right as consumers to respond to it. If you do a particular action, you cannot expect for us to have a reaction to it. You can't just expect us to sit on our hands and say, okay, so that happened. No, it doesn't work that way. We're going to respond to it. Maybe it's by saying, hey, you know what? Maybe we don't want to associate with you anymore because maybe you didn't go to him for some clarification of what was going on. They never talked to him. They never said anything to him. They said, oh, we dropped him. That's it. That's all. Sucks to be you. But did you actually ask him what was going on? Did you actually say, hey, did you say X, Y, and Z or A, B, and C of what was going on there? What did you say on the Destiny podcast? What were you trying to say there? What were your viewpoints about it? Does your viewpoint have any change between then and now? What were you actually trying to say? Why were you saying that? They could have had an actual conversation. Instead, they chose this route and then to ban people on Steam forums, civil people on the Steam forums, for asking for a refund. They have a right to do that. I don't care what you think about JonTron's viewpoint. They have every right to a refund. What was he going to say in Ukulele that had anything to do with what he said on the Destiny podcast? What did that have to do with anything? What was his character going to say? What was his character going to say that would have been so racist? Which, by the way, we'll get to that when we talk about Jim Sterling's review of Ukulele. And you may be wondering, what does this have to do with YouTube AdSense? What does this have to do with ads being pulled from YouTube? Be a little patient, because I also want to talk about what Jim Sterling's review had as an effect on NeoGAF. I don't think this is just a random group of people who decided that they were 5-1-0 after Jim Sterling for both Breath of the Wild reviews and for his ukulele review, which is, by the way, a 2 out of 10, which he's one of the few that actually uses the number system to its full extent. You know what he said in the ukulele review, which, by the way, was about a game that he contributed to through Kickstarter, which he disclosed, by the way, for anybody who's wondering about Lele's dialogue. He said, quote, "The dialogue as written is only slightly less painful, with terrible jokes that undeservedly throw shade at other games and Lele's witty quips routinely insulting the looks of any creature that isn't her, often using derogatory nicknames based on their appearance. She'll toss out slurs against snakes, shopping carts, clouds. She doesn't care. Lele is a complete racist, and as facetious as I'm being here, she really does come off as a hateful, nasty, thoroughly unlikable little bastard." Now, take that into consideration when you understand what Playtonic did to JonTron. What did they think he was and what they didn't want to be associated with? And then think about what Jim Sterling said about Lele's dialogue. It does seem as though they were trying to talk out of both sides of their mouth there. But you know what I think? I think that these people who have been complaining about Jim Sterling and his reviews have come majorly from NeoGAF, since they were the majority of the people who were going off about his review, even going so far as to stalk his Twitter account and trying to find the littlest thing that he was trying to say about NeoGAF, as if they should care what he says about NeoGAF. If they don't really care about what he says, why bother trying to look at his Twitter account? So what does this have anything to do with the YouTube advertiser boycott? What does this have to do with any of this? Well, let's take into consideration what they were trying to do to push Playtonic to drop JonTron, and the way many developers seem to still think that NeoGAF has any credibility. And yeah, you'll see the occasional leak from time to time on NeoGAF, but you will not see that much in the way of news anymore. And keep in mind that NeoGAF has been through a lot of controversy lately, especially their owner Evilore, or Tyler Malka, if you want to believe the things about his so-called pedophilia remarks. And don't ask me to go into direct detail about what those are, because I'm just paraphrasing at this point. I'm just putting that out there. If you want to believe that, then you can go on Google and search for those things if you want to get some proof of that one way or the other. However, it has become well aware by the general public that NeoGAF has become sort of a toxic community. Their administrators have been known to ban anybody within the slightest bit of opposing viewpoints from what they want to have out there. And it's one thing to moderate the site with the rules that you want. You have every right to enforce any rule you want on your website. This is your website. However, when you have developers who are looking at your site, and when you have rules that are not enforced consistently on both sides of the political fence, and when you consider that they have banned Bookie2988 for just calling for calm about things that were going on in 2014, and then saying, oh, well, now he's siding with JonTron because he won't throw him under the bus and call him a racist piece of trash, when you're having people on that site that will let go a person who is calling for Total Biscuits cancer to take him quicker, and you're allowing that to continue on your site while you're banning anybody who even says a letter of dissent to the administrator's own viewpoint and letting the other side get away with whatever the fuck they want. When you allow that to happen, what do you think we're going to suspect about your site? Here's the thing. NeoGAF, I think, has got to be one of the major players of this thing, because the second that Wall Street Journal said anything about PewDiePie, they wouldn't believe it without any bit of questioning. The same with JonTron, the same with Boogie, the same thing with Total Biscuit, and just about any other YouTuber out there. What makes you think that the people of NeoGAF are the ones that are also trying to push YouTube in order to do any of this stuff. This is just me speculating. This is just me being conspiracy theorist. But you know what? There might be something there, because the way that they've already pushed the thing about JonTron. Although, to be fair, you probably didn't need to push hard for Playtonic to play ball, because they probably were ready to ask how high they were going to need to jump for them. And the way they can be so influential to other people in the game industry, what makes you think that they might have something to do with this as well? Now, it could be other people as well. I'm not saying that it is or isn't. I'm just putting it out there that I am very suspicious about how much influence NeoGAF has right now that they should not have. And they have that much power because the developers and people will allow them to retain that much power and will not question it outside of the few people who don't have as much of a voice as some of the bigger people do have, like Jim Sterling has. He actually called out NeoGAF, and good for him. He actually called him out. But again, there's NeoGAF going out there, and guess what? His site actually got DDoSed on the back of the ukulele review. How pathetic is that? And you don't want me to think that there might be something with them in a YouTube scene as well? There has to be something there. They don't like YouTube. They think that YouTube is a bunch of right-wing fascists. And no, I'm not saying the people from NeoGAF are responsible for the DDoS attack either. I'm just saying, think about that. Think about what could be going on at this point. And you don't think that YouTube could be feeling pressure from people like NeoGAF or from a group like that, something like 1 million moms and 1 million dads, something like that, pressuring YouTube to say, you better not even try to monetize this particular channel or this particular video, or else we're going to go after you because we have so much power. You don't want to mess with us. You don't want to cross us. How much you want to bet there's something there, that there is a third party at work there? Maybe not NeoGAF, maybe some other particular group that we don't know about yet that's working behind the scenes here that they don't want us to know about that they even exist, let alone they're pushing YouTube into this situation. Maybe it is the Wall Street Journal that is saying, hey, YouTube, you know we have something on you. You might not want us to report that they're blackmailing YouTube or they're pressuring YouTube into this situation. It could be NeoGAF for all we know. I'm just saying NeoGAF is a likely proponent of this from what I have seen in the past, from what I have seen them saying about YouTube personalities in the past. Them saying, oh, well, if they say one thing wrong, we have to just dispose of them as friends. Like, friends are disposable. No, they're not. I'm not going to dispose of my friends because they're my friends. They're not going to just go away like that. Yeah, I'm going to say how wrong they are if they're not acting the way that I think they should. But you know what? We do that as people we know, as friends, as people who we think should know better. And we try to work things out. We actually discuss things. We actually talk about things. They've scolded me for quite a few things. I know that my friends have actually scolded me for a few things that I have done, that I have said. And I more or less deserved it. I am not perfect. No one should expect for others to be perfect. People make mistakes. And I don't get where forgiveness has just gone by the wayside. We hold grudges forever and ever and ever. You want to take the third party block list into account. But here's the thing I want to get to. And I know I rambled about other things. But the thing about David Pakman and the way that YouTube has just said, hey, we don't want you to advertise on this channel. We are not going to accept your request. And yes, I do understand that in this particular time of year, advertising revenue usually decreases because it's right after the holiday season and things just kind of stagnant at this point, and it kind of picks up as the year goes along. And I understand that, and I think that might have something to do with it. So we should not freak out just yet. And we have seen before that people can misrepresent the reasons why some people may pull advertising or something else. It might be that just Volkswagen or Pepsi or Coca-Cola might be saying, we don't want to buy advertising for YouTube right now, but we'll come back when the time's right because of the usual fall off at that point of the year. That may be it. However, when a particular company actively says that's the reason they're pulling their ads, you have to at least be a bit suspicious as to what could be going on. You have to think that perhaps that's what's going on, that it is because of this demonetization thing. And when YouTube is acting on knee-jerk reactions and they will not tell you anything. And when they will outright refuse an advertiser's explicit request to advertise on a particular channel, they are not giving the advertisers any bit of choice in the matter. They're not even asking them. They even wanted this system to be implemented in. Like, they didn't ask for any game developers if they wanted the automatic claiming of videos to be implemented into the system and punishing less players. That is a sign that, one, they're not doing enough communication, something we've said again and again and again, and they have refused to even address that that's a concern we have. They have refused to even respond, saying, hey, we might want to communicate with you guys a little bit better about what might be going on. We might need to open up a little bit of communication. Don't hold it behind the YouTube Heroes paywall. Why are you making that a privilege, not a right? Why are you doing that? And they won't communicate about that either. But when you factor all of that in, and you also factor in that when you appeal, you don't even get to say your piece. You say, click a button and you appeal it without saying, wait a minute, this is why I'm appealing, like you do with the DMCA stuff, which you still haven't figured out, YouTube, by the way. This is something on top of that. Don't forget, where is the fair use? That hasn't gone away either. We're not forgetting about that, YouTube. That's going on with this recent issue. But when you don't give us even the ability to say why we are appealing, and to give us even a hint of why it's a problem, why you don't want to monetize that, why you don't want to give us the ability to do that, that makes us suspicious. That makes us want to find answers. If you're not going to give us answers, we're going to go looking for them. And this is not going to go away. We're not going to stop talking about it. This is going to go on until you fix it, and until you tell us who's pressuring you or why you're doing this. This is something that we're not going to stop talking about. We're not going to stop pressuring you about. Make no mistake about it. 1 year down after Doug Walker started the WTFU campaign, we're still using that hashtag. That has not gone away. You thought this app was going to go away? It hasn't. Neither will this. We are not going to stop talking about this. This is going to be something that is going to continue until you do something about it. Don't think that we're going to get off of your case about this. This whole thing with communication has been something that has been ongoing for quite some time, and we haven't stopped talking about that either. So don't think that these problems are something we just forget about. And we're especially not going to stop talking about it if we find out that you're taking orders from a third party, especially one that has more influence on industries than they should. And no one calls them out on it. No one high up calls them out on it. And I'm pretty sure NeoGAF is watching this right now and is wondering, why is someone with a chipmunk sounding voice questioning what we do? Because you know what? One, I've heard it all. I don't think I can hear any other insult already about what I look like, how I sound. Yeah, I think I've heard at all. And second of all, because someone has to do it. But yeah, I think now you understand why I came to that conclusion. The details about what caused me in order to believe what's been going on could be a third party. Although this is me just speculating. You can take it for what it's worth. I would love to hear your comments about this, about what you think about my theory. Bottom line is that we need to stop taking every single person at their word. Remember, Wall Street Journal is owned by News Corp. Same people that own Fox News, who's been spinning things for years now, who had some judge on their airspace on Fox and Friends say that Trump bombing Syria was a good thing, and we should all be proud of him. Hello, are you ready to believe the Wall Street Journal, who is owned by the same company that will allow a person to say that with a straight face, who will allow a person like Bill O'Reilly to continue to hold a job after yet another sexual harassment suit? You seriously are going to believe someone about PewDiePie who didn't go to him, didn't talk to him before they went after him on their article, when they have so much questions to be answered on their own behalf, on their own character, on the employer's own character? Let's consider several sources. And I know that I'm taking Jim Sterling by his word on this particular review, but you know what? I have a reason to, because he hasn't exactly directly been wrong about the kind of things he said about certain games, especially with digital homicide. And he has said some things I disagree with him about as well. So it's not like I'm taking him completely by his word, but on this particular thing about particular games, yeah, I'm ready to believe him, especially when you're talking about these particular issues. No, we shouldn't be freaking out about these YouTube situations just yet, because again, this is a particular time in which ad revenue is usually down. This is a time of year that usually happens, and we've been hearing about it for a couple years now that this is usually the time of year that we usually see a decrease in ad revenue. But this probably is happening at the worst possible time when you have both of these things going on, and it seems that the boycott is having a bigger effect than the usual drop off that you usually will see. And when you have a suspicion of third parties involved, because YouTube will not communicate about anything to anybody, maybe even to the privilege that they have on the YouTube Heroes program, and you consider all these other things that have been going on recently, especially the attacks against other YouTubers and the blind way that we believe these certain sources, even above our own friends who might know a person better than that stranger from the Wall Street Journal or Kotaku or Polygon might even know him or even care to know him or even care to research about him. When we're ready to do that, we are part of the problem. We are not part of the solution, and we have to become part of the solution, because if we don't do that, then we're just going to continue on this downgrading of society. This is a byproduct of this. These people do not have the right. They should not be given the privilege to try to destroy a platform that has given ordinary people the ability to say what's on their minds regardless of the political leaning they have. Not all right-wingers are racist. Not all left-wingers are loons. And if we can understand that and we can act with that in mind, things like this advertiser boycott will never happen, because the Wall Street Journal and people like him would never get past the front door with it. They would get laughed out of the building. And instead, we've given them too much power because we have been indoctrinated in that sort of way. And we become too afraid to talk about these kinds of issues, about social issues, because we are too afraid of what people will think. We're too afraid of losing friends over it. We are too afraid of losing followers or subscribers over it, because what we have become, how sensitive we have become, and the ways we react before thinking. And it's caused people to have this kind of power to do stuff like this, to pressure YouTube into these kinds of things, because we cannot grasp that just because someone's right wing or left wing doesn't mean they're in the fringe part of it. Let's stop reacting in a knee-jerk way, or else we're going to give these people more and more and more power to pressure stuff like this. And these ordinary people who have made a living off of the YouTube platform, which is a viable platform, it is a viable way to make a living. Someone who has spent hours upon hours editing videos to perfect their craft in order to make sure that their sound is right, in order to make sure they have the right microphone or the right recording software or the right editing software, or the time that they spend in order to make sure that their opinions are crafted exactly the way they want to express them, and then find the words to express them right, and then to be constantly worried that one syllable that they could possibly say could be enough to make people hate them forever before they even have a chance to say, wait a minute, that's not what I said at all. Please stop saying that. This is not a real job. You have no idea. If you really think that, you have no idea what gets put into this. If you think that you can do this, try it. It is so worth it, but it is such a time-consuming job. It is such a time-consuming effort to do, but it is so worth it. And the people who love to do what they do with this, the people that I've seen who do this kind of thing much better than I can, who have voices that don't sound like they came straight out of a chipmunk's cartoon, there's people who have worked so hard in order to get the subscribers and the following that they have gotten, to make sure that people will want to watch the videos, that they have that personality, and then to have that one thing that they do, that one syllable that they say that one person took the wrong way, or one had a episode of spite that they wanted to take that person down, and they knew how to do it, and they knew how to get people to believe them. Regardless of where your political leanings are you ready to say that they have not worked hard enough in order to gain that following? If you really want to debate any one of those people who are saying this or that or this about either left-wing or right-wing editing issues, get yourself a microphone, get yourself a pop filter, get yourself some editing software, get yourself something and start recording your voice. Start getting involved in it. You'd be surprised how much it is worth it, how much fulfillment you will get, even though it is a time-consuming thing. It is such a great thing to be able to do. And to deny people that ability to make a living off of something they'd love to do. What if I told a person who loved to draw, who loved to make comics, that they weren't allowed to make money out of making their webcomic anymore? Or they weren't allowed to DJ a show anymore if they were a music DJ for weddings or invitationals or graduations or something like that? What if I told them that they couldn't practice medicine or something of that sort, that they couldn't do what they love to do? That is what you are telling these people they can't do by supporting something like this, assuming they are. Don't allow yourself to be a part of this problem. Not all journalists are bad people. Most of them are good people, but there are these other people in this particular medium who have this desire to destroy something that they see as competition. If you want to compete with somebody, just compete with them. Be better than them. Produce better material. Don't try to destroy a platform without putting in work to make your own platform better, because that just creates a whole load of problem for consumers and for people who desire for a more civil, unbiased debate about issues, about gaming, about politics, about all sorts of other things. Hell, maybe if you competed with them, you might see more people wanting to go to your videos, maybe your content, because in the end, when you have competition, the consumer wins. Have we forgotten that? But in order to do that, we have to call it out. We have to call you out, and to do that, we have to call ourselves out when we give you way too much power. Maybe that's why this whole thing has blown up. Maybe we just gave them too much power and they gotten an inch and they taken a mile. Let's hope that this gets through to certain people. And again, if you think I'm a racist, I'm a bigoted, I'm a homophobic person, you are an idiot, because you should know better. Just look at my past and you'll see that that's not the case. And with that having been said, thank you very much for hearing me ramble yet again about this particular issue. Please leave a comment down below about what you thought about my theory and about my opinions about this issue. Please like this video, give me a thumbs up if you liked it, and subscribe for more Geek Gaming Culture. I do appreciate everyone who subscribes and leaves a comment and likes the videos. Again, I read everything, although I may not have enough time to respond to every single comment. Please keep that in mind. And I apologize for that. Until next time, my name is JD Shadow, and that just happened.